Hi everyone. Let's give one more minute before we start.
Hi, Varuth.
Hi. Varuth. Hi. Okay, I think we can start now. I hope you guys were able to follow through the instructions for the first few modules. I'm hoping that you guys are very clear on both how to use NumPy and Pandas.
Following
Today,
with pandas was a little difficult. NumPy was easier for me compared to pandas was a little difficult to follow.
oh, so generally, usually when I was learning, I found it other way around. Like I found Pandas much more intuitive, perhaps because it looks a lot more like Excel. And but no worries, like you can reach out to me anytime if
See,
you're
the
stuck
reason
anywhere.
was you covered NumPy like a teacher, and we were able to connect and follow up. Maybe that's why NumPy looked easier for me compared to pandas.
Okay, so I suggest like I've uploaded some more material and attached few documents. Okay, let's go through that. Okay, so I have attached one Pandas notebook here. Okay, so when you go to week 4 link, you will find some more helpful things on Pandas. So this particular notebook where I've analyzed 1 million movie ratings by IMDb, you'll find it very helpful. It's a step-by-step sequence of how Pandas is done. Otherwise, one of the best places where you can find to learn how to learn Pandas is also, and what I would suggest you explore more often, is a place called Kaggle. Kaggle is a place where generally it's considered one of those websites where ultimately most of the machine learning data ends up. So you'll find every possible type of data, every possible type of analysis being done. So, and also it's a place where most of the companies now upload their data sets with their problems and attach a prize money to it. It's a hugely prestigious event in sense if Kaggle grandmasters are directly picked up by recruitment companies at very, very high salaries. Even most of the data analytic type of jobs, recruiters would often look for participation in Kaggle. So it also has, let's say, some courses. These are very, very fundamental line by line handholding. So you will see Pandas here, creating, reading, and it's broken down into very elementary topics. And is this way because if you complete this, you should be able to do pretty much any kind of thing that you. So it would have exercises, tutorials. Let's say I'm clicking on tutorials. It would give a very detailed step-by-step details on how to start with pandas, how do you create a data frame, how do you analyze it, so on and so forth. So this is also a very good source. However, what I would want all of you to do is go through this week 4 material and ensure that you understand everything. So this is week 3, week 4 material. Make sure you understand all of these things, because there are two things. This week and next week are the last weeks of this particular stage of our learning. That means after this, I hope that you're able to use both NumPy and Pandas comfortably, and you're able to visualize things. That means now you know enough Python to start learning the actual machine learning algorithms. Things would get much more interesting then when you start doing this. And also, because we would keep using this, it will keep you will keep learning and adding to your skills about NumPy and Pandas as you move into machine learning aspect of it. So go through this. Next week again we will cover same NumPy, Pandas and visualization. So this week and next week would be just ensuring we understand all of this. I have attached a day-by-day schedule. So this is what I found evenly spaced. So if you dedicate 1 hour per day, you should be able to do all of this fairly comfortably. And I've left one free day. So 5 days, 5 hours next week. If you stick to this, I think you should be able to start with machine learning and you should not have any problem. Okay. With that being said, let's start. I think I will not pick up any new topic, but let's try to analyze a particular data set, which is a sort of introductory data set any newcomer into machine learning is generally given. This is the introductory, very basic, elementary type of data set. It would give you a good flavor of what machine learning is. Let's pick up that data set, and it's a real data set. It's not fictitious. It's not made up data set. Let's work on that and then reinforce our understanding of pandas and some of the visualization techniques. I'll cover that. I'll share that notebook. I'll add it here only. So next week, go through this. And then next week, I'll again have a rundown of everything we have done in our last 4 sessions. And week after that, we will start our machine learning journey. Okay, that sounds fair?
Yep.
Yes,
okay. I have picked up a data set called Titanic data set. You can mostly, if you just Google Titanic data set, you will find the actual data set anywhere. So you'll have multiple, and you see Kaggle, as I said, most of the data ends up here. It's showing on top. So you can just pick this data set up from here. This is how any data set would look like. So as soon as you go to Kaggle, you can type any whatever data set that you want. Titanic is what we are going to do today. So this is the first one, Titanic. Data would give you what the details of this data. So how is the data? What is the format? What are the variables in that data? Description of the data. Often, whenever you would have a data set provided, usually a separate documentation is also provided on what is this data about, and the person who collected this data would try to his best, her best possible ability, capture everything, data collection methodology, what are the variables. And this is how you would know what this data is about. So what I've done is I've just downloaded this data set. You can here you would see Data Explorer. So test, train. You can download the test one. Next week I'll explain what these test and train are and how every data set in machine learning would be broken down into test and train. So this button would just download it. I've placed it in a folder. So as usual, let me start from beginning actually. I would open my Anaconda prompt. in Anaconda prompt, I'll browse to the place where I've saved this data set. And I will launch my Jupyter notebook. Here you will see all the files in that folder already appearing. I've created a notebook. I would recommend you create your own notebook and try to follow through what I've done here. Let's start with a new notebook and try to recreate. Because we are using NumPy and Pandas, I'll import those. You can do this, but mostly it's customary and convention in machine learning world to import this with an alias. I'm also going to import Pandas as PD. Now these are two new libraries which I'll show you today. One is called matplotlib, and this is how always I will import it, matplotlib.pyplot as plt followed by
Bharat.
Yes.
Sorry. Do we have to download the data set? Along with this and along practicing right now?
I didn't get you. Right now?
Have to download the data set?
Whenever you're doing this exercise by your own, okay. Whatever, ultimately, if you have to work on data, you would need data set, right?
Right now we don't have to, we're just following it, right? I thought we'd be working side by side.
Right. No need to work side by side. I would recommend you ask questions, get your intuition around it. And I'm not going to use anything new beyond NumPy and Pandas.
Okay.
So see this at the end. I will immediately after this class, I'll upload both this notebook as well as instructions on how to get the data set. And then you can try to recreate this by yourself.
Can you please zoom a little? It's tough to see.
Is this fine?
Yeah.
Perfect.
Okay.
Bharat, could you explain what is matplotlib.pyplot and you have used another library, seaborn. Could you explain what is of those?
Sure. So NumPy, Pandas, you would already be aware. NumPy is linear data. So it's just series, arrays. Pandas is where you have multiple series. So imagine it like an Excel, a lot of rows and a lot of columns. And it looks exactly like that. I'll show you. I'll export all the data onto Pandas only. Matplotlib is core plotting library of Python. So when Python started, one of the major objectives was to make publication grade plotting very easily accessible. And very advanced, like you cannot do certain things on Excel. So this is the library which primarily is used for plotting. Matplotlib have multiple things in it where you can put three-dimensional graphs, wire meshes, animations, moving graphs. Pyplot is a part of matplotlib which I will use for most of my work, for most of the 2D graphs which we make. Pyplot is more than sufficient. So instead of loading the entire library, I've just loaded this part of the library as PLT. Because everything ultimately gets loaded onto your RAM. So you should ideally load only the things that you require for your work. So for us today, we would just be doing some basic plotting. And that's why I've just downloaded Pyplot.
Bharat, does that mean that pyplot is just used for two-dimensional graphs, or could it be used for other dimensional graphs?
You can draw three-dimensional graphs. You can do multiple things. For most 90% of the work, pyplot should be enough. But when you get to very advanced things like a moving vector image has to be captured, or you're trying to put some animations onto your graphs. You want some interactivity with your graphs, all those would not be available on just Pyplot. You'll have to download a few more libraries and that's why I've just put pipelot. But I it's very rare that I come across a scenario where pipelot is not sufficient for my work.
Okay, in that sense, it signifies that it could be only used for basic graphs, right?
When I say basic, it should be like 99% of any type of graph you would ever see is already available in pipelot. It's some very, very advanced techniques, like you want to recreate an MRI or a DNA sequence while capturing the dimensionality of it in totality of it, like three-dimensional structure of a protein. In those things, pipelot would not be sufficient. But otherwise, 99% of the cases, pipelot should be sufficient.
Yeah. Okay.
And then matplotlib inline. Because matplotlib is basic native Python functionality, and Python comes with, we are running it in Jupyter Notebook. Remember, Jupyter Notebook is a front end. So what this does is it allows rendering of those Python generated images directly on this console. So this is a standard way to ask import matplotlib plot and ask matplotlib to expose the outcome, the graph directly onto this console on your Jupyter Notebook. This is what this line does. Import Seaborn. Seaborn is a functionality over top of matplotlib. So imagine it as a layer on top of matplotlib. What it does is it adds very nice styling to your plots. So matplotlib is still underlying. The backend of Seaborn is also matplotlib, but Seaborn makes it very, very easy. It's very intuitive to use. Just by using a couple of commands, you can draw almost any type of graph. And it allows you to stylize your graphs to whatever taste that you want. These are very easy to use. So if I just type Seaborn and go to their website, it would have introduction, installing, a very, very detailed tutorial on how to visualize data. So while visualizing statistical relationships, what are the type of graphs you might want to choose? While plotting categorical data, what are the type of things that you might want to choose? So, and it gives very, very simple instructions like tree plot, swamp plot, box plot. And you can click on any of these things. It would give you very detailed documentation on what you have to do. So often what you will find is when you are trying to do certain things in machine learning, when you're trying to visualize some data, you would often have an intuition of what you want to do. And then next thing you will do is you'll Google, like, okay, this is what I want to draw. Go to a particular library and then see how it is to be drawn. And then copy paste it onto your, you are not expected to remember everything. That's what makes it so powerful, because it relies on your intuition. So your intuition and fundamentals should be strong. Code you can search from anywhere on Google. It's always available. Someone would have already done it. It's very well documented. So don't focus much on memorizing code. It will become your second nature. But I often rely on Google and then copy paste the code. So let's read this. Just give me 1 minute. I'm so sorry. Sorry, I got a call. Okay, so here I have this data test, which I want to read now onto my pandas. This is how it looks on Excel. Let's see how it would look once we load it. So I'm assigning a variable to it. Okay, so I typed something. I assumed it was a CSV file. I just typed test and it gave me an error. File does not exist, test. Let's see what actually went wrong. I'm trying to see this file extension, if it's a CSV or something else. It is a .csv file.
XLSX?
It is a CSV file, file name extension. So if you see, now it's a CSV file. What Python expects me to do is provide full details of it. This is the most common mistake that anyone starting out would do, because we are so used to Windows, we often would ignore these. And it's in the file extension that captures the information about what is the structure of data inside. So CSV is comma separated values, and that's how Python would know. If it's a CSV, I have to use it as read CSV, and I'm reading it in pandas. I imported pandas here as PD, so I'm using one of the functionalities of panda to read it. If you see, I'm just typing read underscore and tab. You can read it from clipboard as well. If you have copied something, control C somewhere, and you do control V, it would actually get copied. CSV, Excel, Feather has numerous formats. So I'm just trying
read to read underscore this. CSV is a keyword. It means it is, so it's not made up. It is
exists. Usually whenever you pass a file name here, just remember that you would always be expected to provide the extension as well. So if it's a .txt file, I would read it as pd.read table and whatever the file name is, file.txt, something like that. But I would always give the file extension name. Otherwise, Python would throw up an error.
Okay, Bharat. So that means if we are passing an Excel file, then it will be read underscore CSV. If we file a Word doc file, then that read underscore becomes something else, is it?
I didn't get you. What?
See, test is an Excel file, right?
Right.
Is that the reason we are giving read underscore CSV, or else we would have given it something else if it was a Word document or a text file that changes yes. every time?
Yes. So let's say I'm creating a text document and I've just put some random lines here, saving it just to show you. Is equal to PD. In fact, it won't be a PD format because it's not a table that I've stored in here, but let's try to read it. See. This is what I wrote inside this text. So because it's a text file, I'm just reading it as table. So when you're not sure of what the data is, just use read.table. And otherwise, everything would have a certain type. So pd.read underscore. If it's an Excel file, .xls, .xlsxs. All those would go into Excel. Feather is a separate format. FWF is a fixed width format. So if you have data in text file, which looks like this. Header 1. 1, 2, 3, 4 spaces. Header 2. 1, 2, 3, 4 spaces. Header 3. ABC. 4 spaces. So I've created something like a fixed width file. See, because I have given it as fixed width, it has automatically detected the structure of data that it's all the data elements are separated by some fixed constant width. You don't need to specify how big it is, what is the width size. It's done by Python itself. So it has detected header 1, header 2, header 3. It had one row of data, and perhaps I have given it a Okay, this spacing was not right when I typed it out, but otherwise it would have put ABC here, here, and this would have come here.
Bharat, one question. So in your first example, you can do a PD dot read table and pass the CSV as well, right? That should also work. It would just be in a...
Yeah, I would not do that because each of these functions would have quite a lot of a very specific code behind it. So that code would determine. So it the fixed width file would just like fixed width file. When you use that, it detects the width by which each element is separated like that. CSV would separate it by a comma, but it will also identify whether it's a numeric value, whether it's a categorical value, so on and so forth. What are the missing values? If something is a float or a number, if something is a string, something is a special character, it would read all that. So ideally, you should know your data. That's why documentation becomes so important. So here in Kaggle, where I downloaded this data from, it would give all the information about data. What are these numbers? If these are numbers, if this is just something else, this is categorical data, where C means this, Q means. This all is available when I use this .csv. So I would, though you can read it, but I would recommend that you use something which is specifically designed for that task. For CSV, this is the function which is very specifically designed for CSV. It's optimized for that and hence this. But otherwise, Python would still go ahead and read it if you give it FWF.
Yep. Thanks.
Okay. So this is how Titanic data looks like. You would see to conserve space, Python would trim. In sense, it would show these dot dot dots and then rest of the data, but it would give you dimensions. It has total 418 rows and 11 columns. If it had multiple columns which cannot be fitted here, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, but it had 20 or similar kind of dots would appear here, it would not show you everything. Let's try to understand this data now that we have loaded it. Now this is called Pandas. Pandas has loaded it exactly how the Excel would have shown you this data. So first thing, often what I would do is I would want to know the shape. So same thing, it comes here. So there's something called describe. Describe at one shot for each of these columns would give you certain statistical measures, like how many of them are present, how many values are present. So there are 418 rows. You see 418 comes everywhere. It would give you mean of all the values here. It would give you standard deviation, minimum value, 25th percentile, 50th percentile, 75th percentile, and maximum value. Now you would see that we had 11 columns, but here it shows only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's perhaps because passenger ID is there, class is there, age is there. So we are missing name. Why name is missing? Because it's just pure text. These kind of statistical measures would not mean anything on this. And that's why it would have ignored it. It's often a good way to understand what is the shape of each of the distributions in these. So let's say age, your mean age, by the way, this data set is from the Titanic journey, which on which unfortunately it sank and quite a lot of people died. This is just a background of this data. It would give you survival rate of, okay, I'm using test. That's why it's not showing survival. I should have used the train data set. Train has this column, so let's read the train one. One column extra. This got added. So it gives you passenger IDs. Zero means they did not survive. Survival, zero means no, one means yes. This is real data set, so everything that everyone who was tagged with zero would not have survived. Everyone with one would have survived. It gives what class they were traveling in. There are three classes for which tickets were available in Titanic. Name of person, their gender, age, SIB, SP. Is number of siblings, spouse on board Titanic. So size of perhaps their entire troop which was traveling. P arch. Number of parents, children. The ticket number, fare, cabin, embark. Where did they embark from? Cabin is what was their cabin. And usually this data set is... when I said there is train and test data set, and earlier I loaded test, it did not have survive, right? So what it's a typical machine learning problem where first you take train data set, you create your model. Remember last time when I said that what machine learning essentially is about reading the data and finding out patterns. So when you create a model, it would read this data, understand the pattern, and then determine with any given of other data, can it predict whether the person would have survived or not? For that, you have a test data set. And in that test data set, you will not have this survived column. And your machine will predict that. And you would see solutions also provided, and it gives you, you can match how accurate your algorithm is. Okay. So describe gives you all those measures. I would suggest be very familiar with what does mean, standard deviation, these percentiles mean. So let's take one quick example, age. Now there are, now you will see in this data set, while the number of rows are 891, it shows 714. That means our first inference is there are some rows in which age is missing. And that's why this number is low. It's not matching the number of rows. First, of the rows for which age was available, the mean age was around 26.69. So around 30 years. Standard deviation gives how wide is the spread of this data. Minimum age was 0.42 and maximum age was 80 years. Now, this would give me the spread of age. 50th percentile is 28. That means half my population is between this and 28. Rest half is between 28 and 80. So what does it tell? Majority of my, the most number of people are on average youngish in this journey. 25th percentile is at 20. What does this tell me? 25, first, fourth. If I lined up all the passengers in a row and ask them to stand as per their age, youngest one ahead and the oldest one behind. And then I cut this line into four equal parts. Then the first part would be between this range, minimum and this. The second part is between this range. The third part is between this and this. The final group is between this and this. So it roughly gives you a sense of what, how many of what is where. How this is generally called a distribution analysis, where you can find distribution of this. And let's come to that also. One of the easier ways to do it is Titanic or seaborne pair plot. Here I've just used sns.pairplot. What it does is for every possible column, it would draw a graph comparing it to every other column. So if you see this one, fare versus passenger ID, fare versus survived, fare versus class, fare versus age, and so on and so forth. Diagonally, you would see distributions of this. So how was age distributed? How was survival rate distributed? So survival rate, you will see it's either 0 or 1. P class, 0, 1, 2, 3. There were only 3 classes. Age, as I said, most of the people looked from this inference as a little younger. You would see peaking out a little left. It's not actually a perfectly symmetrical mound. So this tells me it's a little young. Siblings. Quite a lot of people traveling did not have any sibling beyond two people. So these are the things that you can infer. So it's always good when you start with data set to understand your data set. And that's how you do it. So pair plot is one way where you can see there's quite a lot going on. So we will come back to this, but let's see what else can we find. We have some age groups which are missing. Dot columns info. Okay. So if you want to see all the columns, if let's say we had more than 12 and it was not properly displayed, dot columns would give you how to display it. So this gives me all the column names. If I want to find, similar to describe, if I want to find some information about type of data, if I type dot info, while dot describe describes this data, dot info would give me information about type of data. So it tells me there were 12 columns, right? So 0 to 11, 12. Each of the column ID, and then it tells me how many null values. So 891, 891, age 714. This would tie back to this, the count of non-null values. Here, I think what we missed here was data which was textual in nature, like name, cabin. Cabin is an alphanumeric, so it didn't get, Python didn't bucket it as a pure number. It would most generally be as a text. So all that can be seen here. Passenger ID, integer. Survived, integer. P class, integer. Name is an object. So text also comes as object here. Age is a float because we had decimals in there. Integer, integer. Here, what additional thing we found was, along with age, cabin has quite a lot more missing. So out of 891 rows, cabin has only 204 values. So let's see what we can gather from this missing data. We have duplication check. Okay. One of the quick ways to this entire analysis would be about who survived, who did not survive. So here, either survive would be 0 or 1. For things like this, your descriptive statistics like mean, standard deviation would not mean much, actually. So because it's either 0 or 1. PD dot value counts would give you exactly what you're looking for. How many zeros, how many ones. So what are we looking at? Survive. So PD dot value counts would give you unique categories in that if it's a categorical data. So it had only two types of two unique categories, 0 and 1. And it will give you how many 0, how many 1. What else is like categorical? P class is categorical. If I put P class. Class 1 had 216 passengers. Class 2 had 2 passengers. Class 3 had these many passengers. But let's say now I want to know how is the breakup of survival, people who survived or not, depending on this.
Bharat, I have a question.
Yes.
The survival thing, it's either zero or one. Why did not Python, while reading it, classify it, use a Boolean data type for that?
Why did it not use?
Boolean data type.
Oh, Boolean data type has to be explicitly mentioned as true or false. While Boolean data type in the front is true or false, at the back end, on actual RAM, physical memory, false is zero, true is one, all the time. So if you change the data type of this to Boolean, it will still look like zero and one.
Okay.
PD dot cluster, I want this with so I have put same thing, instead of value counts, I have put a cross tab. Cross tab is when you want something on rows and something on columns. So here I wanted class on rows and I wanted this to be broken down by survived. Now I know for each class what is the percentage who survived, what is the percentage who did not survive. I can do this for any other. Let's say there is gender. I can do this. This gives very interesting fact actually. So on that day, if you were a female, you're much more likely to survive the entire episode than if you were a male. Now this has some logical explanations, perhaps because when the lifeboats started, a preference was given to female passengers and children. Now this is how your usual data analysis would start. You would have some understanding of something that's called a hypothesis. Now you test a hypothesis. Here is where we are testing. So your hypothesis was, because lifeboats carried mostly women and children, you would lead to a conclusion or a hypothesis that perhaps because of that, you should see higher survival rate among female passengers. And this is how you would test your hypothesis. Okay, let's check this out. So I've drawn a cross tab between gender and survive. And I actually do see indeed that out of females, more likely are to survive than males. So out of all females, 233 survived and 81 did not. But if you see males, only 109 survived out of 468 plus 109. That's a very high percentage of survival among females. Okay, so we are getting a hang of what our data is looking like, how we are testing our hypothesis. This is usually cleaning of data and understanding of data is where most of the data analysts or scientists would spend most of their time on. 90% of the time is spent understanding the data, trying to figure out how are these interacting with what we are trying to predict. So how does class has any correlation with survived, or does gender in any way influence our ability to predict who survived, who does not? Getting an intuition around those is very, very important. And these are the things which would help you do that. Once you develop some intuition, now you have to clean the data, because you saw quite a lot of data was missing, especially around K-Bin. Quite a lot of this is missing. Here it's called NAN, which means not a number. Let's see if we can clean this up. I'll keep referring back to my notebook because I had put a structure to it. I'm just mindful while talking. I don't get too carried away with something and miss the flow of it. Okay, so this is the plotting part of it. Okay, here is when it comes to missing data. Okay, let's see some plotting before we get to the missing data part. This is where you can use Seaborn as well as Matplotlib. So let's say I want to plot this instead of just seeing it as a value count. I want to see this as a graph. And I don't know anything about Python. Let's do exactly the way I would do if I didn't know anything. So I go to the C1 website. It can be Matplotlib as well. So both are extremely intuitive and easy. So I'll show you both of them. Matplotlib, visualization with Python, blah, blah, blah. What do I want to do? I want to create plots. I just clicked that part, which said develop with just few lines of code. Let's see. Okay. What do I want? I want a group bar chart. Yeah, that looks like it. Let's say I want a group bar chart. Import matplotlib, import matplotlib.pyplot as plt. This exactly is what we have done. So what is it doing? It's categorizing between men and women, and it's doing all of this. Axis.bar. So what I would generally do it is I'll copy paste this and then back calculate labels G1, G2, G3 here. What do we want? We want our survival instead of that. I'll just replace that. And I don't want means and all these numbers to come. So I'll delete just rest of it. I'll delete. And because we have used that percentage here, remember I told you it allows you to print the output directly. We need not use plt.show. Same with C1. Tutorial, categorical. In categorical, I want box plot. So what does it say? C1.boxplot.
Bharat, what is this labels for? I know what are labels, but what are these signifying here in Titanic?
Which one? I didn't get you. Labels. What labels?
Means what is the significance of having these five labels?
I didn't get you. Where are you seeing labels?
You showed just now, right? The example where you were trying to use it from.
Oh, here?
Yeah.
Oh, no. I'm just saying if I have to use a graph, usually I'll go to this website. I'll see what type of graph I want and then see how is this graph getting constructed. So here, okay. This graph is based on x-axis. It's G1, G2 something. And this okay. G1, G2 is coming here. What do I want? I want this survived 0, 1 to come here and I don't want G2. So I'll just replace this with my variable and that's how I would go about it. Same way with C1. I'll just copy paste this and see how this works. So without any understanding, I was just wanting to show if something is very new, if you're new to this, I don't need to type C1 because I have imported it as SNS. But now I know I need to put dot box plot X. What is my X? Titanic survived is my X. Y, I don't want any Y. Q, I don't want data. I've already provided this. Let's see. If I remove data, what happens? Order, I don't want anything else. So I would just generally delete everything else and then see how does this work. Okay, so boxplot has plotted only the entire thing as one big thing. I want it broken down now. I want a count of this, so it's given me a box. Okay, here box plot is something else. I'm trying to draw a wrong figure. I was using box plot and this is what a box plot is. I want to draw a bar chart. So where is a bar plot? bar plot. Okay. So it shows point estimates intervals as a regular bar. Bar plot represents estimate of central tendency. This is not what I'm trying to do actually. I want a count of these things. Okay, I see something called a count plot. Okay, correct. A count plot can be thought of as a histogram across central tendency and across categorical instead of quantitative variables. Arts is a quantitative variable. It's between 0 and 1. So that's what we would use. Here, if I press Alt Tab, it will always give me same thing, like it would give me documentation on what am I trying to draw. So here you can read actually. So if I pressed Alt Tab, it shows this is how it should be used, cbon.conplot. In our case, we have imported cbon as SNS, so we would always use SNS, X, Y, all those things. So I want this plotted here. So we have around 549 of non-survivors and around 342-ish survived. And this is what it has plotted. Now let's say I wanted something like this, cross-tab one.
So Bharat, can you do the same thing with the cabin class? Will it then have three columns?
Yeah. So P class. Class 1, class 2, class 3. Is that what we were expecting? PD not.
Yeah.
P class. So third class 491. 491 looks about right. First class 216. Yeah. So let's say we did this versus survival. Let's do this. So I want this also broken down by color on survived. So that's where hue comes. Hue, just imagine it as a color. So I want a color differentiation between these. So see, now everything has been broken down again. So class 1 survived is blue, 80. People who didn't survive 80, survived 136. So that's how you can do simple graphs, count plot, bar plot, and there are various others that I have already shown in this. You can go through these on, say, survived based on gender. Okay, let's do that.
Bharat, just a quick question, maybe irrelevant, but that's how you can make the graph more meaningful by saying that this many males, this many females, and in males, this many adults and this many small children, something like that, where males, maybe they have survived, but maybe the male only kids survive and no male proper male adults survived, kind of more complicated, right?
That's how. So usually what you try to do is you start with some basic understanding. So let's say we just started with survived. Okay, we have more number of people who couldn't survive than survived. Okay, among that, let's see how among the survival, how is it broken down by gender? So here I see males, females. Males tend not to survive. Okay, then let's see what's happening exactly here. What is the breakup of this group by age and so on. So you keep drilling down and interrogating your data until you develop an intuitive understanding of what exactly is the story which this data is trying to tell. And it's okay. Often more easy to see it in a visual way than just by looking at these numbers.
Correct. Thank you.
And that's why visualization often is more of an art than science, and it allows us to see things which are otherwise hidden in the data. And that's why I'm just covering these basic things, but you can multiply on it. You can do whatever kind of breakup that you want and continue doing that until you arrive at your proper intuition of what's happening.
One question.
Sure.
Sorry, two. Can we also assign data label on the, you know, histogram bar itself?
Yes. Actual... So if you see the documentation on how do you tutorial. Okay. Controlling figure aesthetics. So in this section, it will tell you what all you can use to see. It has changed the axis grid. It has changed the background. It has changed quite a lot of things on how do you get. You have absolute control over every possible element of this graph.
Okay.
So you can change what appears here. You can change the tick size, tick label, what appears here. So let's do this. So I'm drawing a box plot now. X-axis would be survived. So similar to this 0-1, y-axis would be age, and then I want it again broken down by gender. I'm passing Titanic data set. So here I'm doing this in multiple ways. Up until here you see me using directly the entire thing in Titanic survived. Here I've just typed survived and age. Because I have told that data is equal to Titanic, it knows that in Titanic, go and find a column called survive, go and find a column called age. I'm changing the palette here. So palette would determine how it looks. See, the color schema has changed.
Yeah.
If I just take this off, it goes back to the normal thing. There are millions of these color palettes available. You can change, you can put grid lines, you can have numbers all over, you can put an arrow and put an annotation to it. All of this can be found very easily here.
And for color palette, we have a list also, a dictionary kind of thing.
Yes. Available here. So, Seaborn tutorial. You see, color palettes are also like choosing a color palette. It gives you how to choose a color palette. These are the names of these color palettes. There are like more than a couple of million, which I know. And even if that is not sufficient, you can brew your own color palette. It also tells you how to use very simple things like this to have a color palette. So you can change into the C. So it says color palette blues. Let's try this. A wrong notebook. See, I've changed the color palette from winter to blues. It has gone back to match exactly the color palette, blues here.
Yeah.
If I use this, it would again change to match the color palette. It's as simple as that. You can define exactly what colors also you want by giving hex codes to that color.
Fine, perfect.
Hi, Bharat. Can you please explain what are we looking at the graph? What is it signifying? Means based on the
change. So here we are just trying to interrogate the data, trying to develop an intuition. There is nothing specific we are looking at, but generally this is how you would start. You would plot every variable against every other variable, trying to understand what is happening with that variable, developing some intuition on the data. Why we are doing it is I just wanted you to get comfortable with this visualization. Mostly this would help you understand your data better. That's about it. There's no specific objective that we are trying to attain here. Our only attempt is to understand our data better. What is causing what? So here, if you see, passengers of class 3 are more likely to survive than passengers of class 1. things like that. To develop some intuition around it, we are drawing just random graphs. Two objectives, understand our data. Second is to get a hang of this graphing library, Matplotlib and Seaborn. All of this, Panda, Matplotlib, and NumPy, all of this would be used in the next session for machine learning. And that's why I'm just going around how to plot data, whatever type of data that you want, what are the different type of graphs that are available. That's all.
One more query.
Yeah.
Sorry. You know, you have assigned survival as 0 or 1. We can assign a name also over here, something else apart from 0 or 1.
Yeah, you can always change it, but that's how it came with the data. We have not assigned it. I've just read the data, and that's how whosoever collected this data has collected it. I can change it to whatever I want.
Okay.
So let's see if you want to do that really. Let's try doing that. Or in fact, even better, I'll show you how to do that when I'm covering missing data. Okay.
Okay.
So here, this is a box plot. What box plot does is, you remember we had mean, median, these. It draws exactly the same thing in a visual way. So it says this is the center line of this box would represent mean. So among people who did not survived 0, in that mean age of males was higher than mean age of females. And then this gives you the 75th percentile and 25th percentile. And these are the outliers. Outliers are most likely some data collection error. Almost all the time when you are working on real life data set, you will have errors in the way data is collected. Perhaps it was just a typo. Perhaps a data point was not available and that was left blank or something like that. These all come up as these dots outside this. So usual practice is to see these outliers and either discard these from the data set or cap the value till the maximum. This is usually 1.5 times the interquantile range. Interquantile range is the distance between 25th percentile and 75th percentile. But that's when you're actually doing this for real life problems. That's when you would actually discard this. So when we get into machine learning, you will, all algorithms are designed such a way that it would automatically detect and take these off from their analysis. Interesting thing about this block box plot is among the people who survived, the mean or average age was generally common. It did not vary between males and females. But however, amongst the people who did not survive, there is a significant difference. Now you can again go back to exploring more on why. Okay, same type of plot, but with a title added. So here, this is x-axis survived, but this is age by gender. But what I have done now is, instead of passing this entire, so someone asked a very nice question on, we see that more number of males died, did not survive, but it might be the young people survived and old people did not. So our intuition was what? First, females and children were allowed in lifeboats. That's why we should see more life expectancy from them than males. But we see abnormally large number of males did not survive. In here, if I want to check that aspect, that I want to see only the people below age 13 and then do this type of analysis. What I've done is I've subsetted this. Now data is only this. I'll explain in more detail. So this is our entire data set. How do I subset this? This is typical pandas. You should be comfortable with this. I'm subsetting this by age less than 13. Now see, only 69 rows. I've just subsetted this with age less than 13. You see all the ages. Now these are less than 13. This is how typically you would subset Titanic or any other data set. You can have as many logic as you want. Let's say I want this to be seen only among females. And Titanic. Remember, these are two equal to's. Equal to is assignment. Two times equals to is a check. I want this to be. Now it has even substituted it by people who are less than 13 and with gender female. That's how you subset this data. So instead of analyzing the entire data set, I have same type of graph. I have passed the data for people less than 13. And now let's see how does this look. Now this changes the entire perception. Like my understanding now is much better. Among people less than 13, you see kids. These are the people who survived. These are the people who did not. Mean age is much less. See, did not survive. The mean is higher than the mean of people who survived. So this tells me in males, generally younger age, infants around between 2 and 6 years are more likely to survive. That again adds back to my intuition, which I earlier had, that kids and females were put in lifeboats. So you would continue to drill down, understand your data set as much as possible. Often I spend, when I start working on a data set, if it's a 3-month project, typically for 2-2.5 months, I would just spend understanding in and out of data. I should know everything about data. I should be able to read it like a back of my hand. The more I do this kind of analysis, the more intuitive I get about my data and the story which my data is telling. Based on that understanding, I would choose which model to use while doing machine learning. Okay, and that's why I'm laying stress. I'm doing so many type of these graphs. Okay, what next?
Bharat, what if we need to have two y-axis? Maybe there are two variables on the y-axis, both on the right-hand side as well as left-hand side. How do we show that?
Okay, so let's start with assuming that two axes is not the best way, or we don't know what is the best way to represent multiple things. So you tell me what are you trying to represent, and I'll tell you a way to represent that. You need not always have two axes. Like here, if I remove this, we are representing survival by age, correct?
Correct.
And let's do a count plot. Okay, count just requires one. Okay, we have number of people who survived, number of people who didn't. Now we want another variable to be added. We want to include this in it. Okay, so we add another axis, y. But now it's just not a count. It's a bar plot now. So I'll change this to bar plot. Y is equal to P class. Now we have added one more, P class. So this gives me a class, but it actually is not looking the way I wanted it to look. How do we represent this P class? Okay, actually bar plot, I want it broken down into multiple pieces. Gallery. Categorical data. Box plot. I don't know. Okay, let's see what this box plot shows. Okay, so I've added age. Now I want, again, add a new variable. Ideally in Excel, you would be used to having this type of thing. If you want to add this P class as well on another Y axis, here. That's why we are breaking this down as U. Now you have broken this down by class as well. So you have various things available to you. Like you can change the color in this as a stack graph, as a something like this categorical plot. Oh,
okay.
I think they have used the exact same example as what we are working on. So you see this class and survival probability by gender as well as the class. So you'll almost always find something which represents whatever, however complex data that you want without needing for another access. Usually it's a very bad idea to have multiple accesses, but when do we use usually a line and a bar is when we would need two accesses. So there is a way to it. There are better ways, in fact. Actually, you can present it as a scatter plot. And let's touch on that. Actually, let me show you how to do scatter plots and all that.
Okay.
For scatter plot, what I would need is two continuous variables, which we don't... Okay, age and fare. These two are continuous in nature. These are not discrete like this. Discrete means it's either 1, 2, or 3. Is either 0 or 1. These are continuous. It can be any value. So if I want to see if there is a relation between age and fare, I would do a scatter plot, something like this. So SNS.scatterplot x and y. Okay. SNS.scatterplot x equal to either. I can now type entire Titanic age and then y equal to, or I can just put their columns, column names, just age and fare, and then pass on data as Titanic. Now within this, if I want to break this down by gender, okay, I need to put entire thing because that's how I have defined it earlier. So you can always keep adding variables to it. You can add a hue, you can add color variable, you can add shape and size. This is how you would get almost everything. So I've used hue as a way to distinguish between these. I can actually would have used size or shape, something like that. So in this, if I want P class also, now I've added one more axis. So in here, the larger number would mean that it's third class, middle type would mean 2, and so on and so forth. So that's how I can keep adding to it and keep building my intuition around it without having to add a second axis around it. But it is possible to add a second axis. This data does not have things which allow me to do that. But let's see if we can... When I pick up the next data set, I'll show you. I'll pick up the data set such that it allows us to have a bar and a line.
Sure, Bharat. Thank you.
Okay. Violin plots are same as how do you Gauss distribution. It's the same cross tab, but I've added some style to it. A CMAP is just same as a CMAP means color map. It's just as what Palais is for graphs, CMAP is for things like this. A different way of visualizing same things again. Class-wise survival. Instead of bar graphs, here I've just chosen a swarm plot. So different ways of visualization would give you different ideas about what your data is. This is how you add a title. Title, X label, Y label. So to the same graph, if I wanted to add a title, title. it would have added a title, but where is the title gone?
Hi, Bharat, one question. So in this graph that you are showing right now, the one with the scatter plot, right? So we have three different kind of variables going in. So you have fare, age, class, and sex. So four basic variables. Now in this graph, if I want to highlight only blue number three, how would I do that? So I want only class three and male. So would that be a filter again going into the scatter plot, or is there a way to basically reduce from this plot itself?
Okay, you want to have males of class 3 identified separately from everything else, correct? Did I get it right?
Yeah.
Okay, so this is how our Titanic data looks like. You want males from class 3. How do I subset it? Now let's copy it. Let's call it Titanic 1. Basically, I want something which I can put on hue. Here it was gender, but I want something in this hue which represents male and people in class 3. So I would just go ahead and create it. Let's first subset this. Titanic. So now this gives me, this is the data set which I want to color separately. I have everything in class 3 and gender male. Okay, for that first I'll create a I've created a column separately and initialized it to 0. So Titanic, now you see identifier, it is all marked 0. Amongst this, what I want is this is equal to 1. Okay, this is just a warning. If it was an error, it would not allow me to proceed. These pink things usually are warnings. What warning tells me is there is a better way to do it. So dot lock is a better way. When you go through my pandas notebook, you will see that dot loc is the actual ideal way to do it. But let's see if it has done that or not. Class 3 male identifier has not turned What am I doing wrong here? Okay, this has pulled up these things. Okay, I got it. This was the mistake. So Titanic dot location, and these are the rows which I want. I want all the rows filtered by gender, male, and P class 3. And I want this column identifier to be marked as 1. Now you see all the class 3 and males have turned 1. Okay. Now using this identifier, I want same thing instead of this. Now everything that is 1 is this color, whatever that color is. So you have exactly done third and males as these colors, and rest of your graph says same. So that's how you create columns. Generally, when you want very specific way of identifying something. So this is why pandas was so important, because for you to visualize, you should be able to work on pandas, be able to slice and dice your data on the fly. Okay. Okay. So actually Titanic dataset has very interesting thing going on class 3. At least that's what I think. So I've given some analysis around here. You can go through this notebook. What I wanted to cover was this is null. Okay, so let's start from the beginning. It's too messy. Titanic dot info. Kevin or age had some missing values, right? Here. So how do you find these missing values? Is null. Now, if you type is null, you're basically asking a question to Python. Is it null or not? False means it's not. True would mean it is. So we are interested in this clearing out this age. So here you see true, but there might be multiple truths, but this is no way of understanding or giving, it doesn't give you a good picture of what exactly is happening. One way is you can create a simple graph like this. So what I've done is, usually you can create a heat map of anything. So let's say I'm creating a heat map. Heat map means it assigns a color to a value, and I want this to be heat mapped. In sense, it has only two values, so ideally I would expect only two type of colors. And let's see what happens. See, everything is one color. The ones which are not in any color are the missing values. So having this versus a visual cue, it allows me to instantly tell that age is somewhere where quite a lot of values are missing. And this gives me what is the range of values that is missing. Kevin have quite a lot more values which are missing. What it also tells me is these missing values are evenly placed. It's not like only older people had data collection issues. Like perhaps you might have a separate line for old age people, and someone collecting this data did not collect an age figure there. So I would expect this part to be missing and rest of it to be fine. Usually those cases are dangerous. You cannot ignore that out in your analysis, but here it's all very evenly spread. So I have two choices to make. I can either discard all of this data with missing values. In that case, it's as simple as Titanic dot drop NA. This would drop all the values. So earlier I had quite a lot of values. Now I have only 183 left. That's because it has dropped everything that is missing. If I don't want all to be, let's try to fix this instead. Let's see if we can impute this data. Okay. So this dot drop NA, remember I did this. I got a new object here. It's not, it has changed it original. It has not changed the original data. So if I just type Titanic, my original data is still there, 891. If you want to drop it in line, then you have an argument called in place is equal to true. If I do this, if I do this, it would actually change the original data set directly. So most of the functions would have something called inline, which will allow you to directly change the data set, or you can create a new data set. If you don't want to destroy your original data set, I can always assign it to a new one. In this case, I have Titanic 1 without any missing values, and I still have Titanic with my missing values. Okay. So let's see what are the type of these missing values. So here it gave quite a lot of is NA or is null. You can use either of them. It just gives me true, false, true, false. Remember at the starting, someone asked a question that why not a Boolean, and that I said Boolean is always 0 or 1. In essence, everything is a number in a RAM. RAM cannot store text. RAM, your system hardware cannot do anything else without a number. Everything is a representation of number in some format. Images, voice, text, data, everything gets converted to a number. The way false and true gets converted is false is 0, true is 1. By that logic, if I do a sum of it, would it give me a hint of what is missing? Because missing ones are true, which means 1. So if I sum all the trues, that means I will get a count of missing values. Let's see if this works. Well, indeed it does. So what I've done is, I've just summed up this is null, which was initially a set of true and false. It was all a set of true and false. I've just put a dot sum. Because all the trues were missing values and true means 1. So it has just given me how many missing values are these. So age has 177 missing values. Okay. What can we do with this? Either we can discard this data, but do you want to discard something valuable? Because it will take away 177 records from your data, which might have some trends to it. Your machine would not have that much data to learn from. It's almost 1/5 of your data. Whenever you have this kind of problem, discarding data is not a good solution actually, because the more data you have, the faster the machine learns and the better it learns. So let's try to impute this. This is all the values and some of them are missing. I want to calculate a mean of these. So mean is this. What I can do is I can replace all of these values by mean. So let's create a new data set. I don't want to corrupt my original one. So I can do a copy. Now Titanic 1. Age dot fill NA. I press shift tab to see. So it tells fill NA. Fill NA, NA and values using specified method. Method can be, there are quite a lot of complicated methods, statistical methods. Or I can fill it with a value. So these are methods. These are not complicated actually. F fill means forward fill. It will take the first value, and if below it is zero, it will just copy down the value. So it is easy to visualize it in Excel.
Go on.
So if I have values like this, forward fill. This method means it will just copy 2 here. So this is how it will replace the value. Backward fill would mean it will get filled from backwards. It will become 3. Backfill, forward fill, pad. Pad would just make it to 0 or whatever we want. None, it wouldn't fill anything. It will just leave it as it is. But it will mark this as something which you can identify later. But what we want to do here is fill it with mean value. So yeah, what I've done is I've saved it as mean age. And so my mean age is what I want to fill it with. Okay, so now Titanic 1 is filled with mean age. Again, I will have to do it in place because I want to replace it.
Bharat?
Yeah?
Just a thought process. Instead of mean age, can we fill it with random numbers which are falling in the maximum distribution, say between 25 to 75% or 30 to 60%
of the there are better ways to do it. I'll exactly come to that. Okay. So first let's do a generic way and then go to a better way of doing it. Okay, 888 value was missing. So Titanic, how do I reference 888th row? You see, 888th row in this was, did not survive, blah, blah, blah. Age was missing. I have replaced it with mean age in Titanic 1. So Titanic 1 dot location 888. You see now age is replaced with mean age, which was 29.699. So I've replaced missing values.
Bharat, what is in place equal to true? Sorry to ask you.
I didn't get you. What?
What is in place equal to true? Can you come little top?
Okay. Yeah, in place. So in place means, if I want to change something here, what I've done, I've taken Titanic 1 age, fill missing values with mean age. Okay. If I remove this, what happens is it will fill all those values, but it has given me a new object with all those missing values filled. But I don't want a new object. I want original object to be changed. So that's where if I put in place is equal to true, this changes the original object. It's not a new object anymore. Got it? This is very important. So you have to be clear about it. Tell me.
Please, can you repeat it? Because I know this is important. It didn't make sense to me when I was learning Panda. So can you please, I could not visualize it.
Okay. Okay. So let's take a toy data set. Let's create a data frame. Okay, let's say we have this and I want to replace this 2 with something else. How do I get to this 2 first? I have to reference it, and because I'm referencing a row in pandas, you would see this method dot loc. I want to get the second element, so that would be indexed 1. Okay, I'll do this side by side so that you're clear. I have accessed this. Okay. Now I want to change this to three. Now if I draw X, it has changed it here.
Mm.
I want this same thing to happen for missing values. Correct? But if I remove this, what it does is, it takes a copy of this age, applies this fill.na and gives me a copy of this. But this is just a copy. My original Titanic data set has still missing values in it. What it has done is it has just read this, changed this and given me a copy of that. But I don't want this copy. What I want is I want to change it directly onto the original records. That is what in place does. If I don't do this, it has just given me a copy of it. If I go back to Titanic 1, nothing would have changed because it has done this on a copy.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so that's why in place is when you want to make your changes persistent and directly to the original data set. That's when you use in place. Okay, so now Titanic 1, we have replaced everything with mean. But let's say we wanted to do something more, do it in a better way. So we want to break down this age into, let's say, multiple buckets. Let's say quantile between 0 to 25%, 25 to 50, 50 to 70. Take the mean of each of these buckets and then fill up the values. I'm a little mindful of that, so I'll directly reuse my code. I had done this. Okay, age band. Okay, let's do it from start because it's important. I'll again create a new data set by copying because I don't want to corrupt my original one, Titanic 1. I'm just checking how many missing values do we have. We have 177 missing values. I want in this a separate column which identifies this bucket, on what bucket is age in. So let's say I want to have a bucket of all the children bit less than 10 years old. Let's say I'm just making up numbers. Titanic dot location. Titanic 1 age. First, I have to create that column and initialize it to 0. So let's call it age bucket is equal to 0, age bucket has become 0. Now on this, now I want age less than, it has identified these many columns. So I want this, and what column do I want? Age bucket. Is equal to, let's say I want it as, now if I see, if I had anyone age less than 1, this age bucket should have changed. Okay, let's try for 22. I want to do similar thing, but with age now greater than equal to 10. And whenever you have multiple arguments, multiple types of checks going, you need to surround them with brackets because, and less than, let's say 50 becomes category 2. See, it has marked everything between that age as category 2. Some might be category 1. And in the same way, I want everyone above age 50 be category 3. Now, what am I trying to do here? Now, everyone has been categorized into one or other category. Interestingly, people without any age has not been categorized because these are missing values. So ideally, this step would come after you fix all the missing values. Unfortunately, I deleted that. So ideally, once you fill up missing ages, then you will do this. So everyone would be categorized into category 1, 2, 3. Now, what do you want to do? Now you would want to replace this missing value from within the category, from whatever category that you have. Okay. Same way. Dot location. I want Titanic 1. I want age bucket is equal to cat 2. This will subset it by only category 2. Okay, I'll explain what I'm doing. In Titanic 1, I want age bucket 2. All the rows having age bucket equal to category 2, and I want column age. I have this now. I want mean of this. I got a mean. Same way as we did previously, we replaced mean. Now we have a mean of only the people in category 2. And I would just again do this. Same way as we did previously, we'll subset it by only the age which is missing in that category and replace it with this mean value. I can do the same with category 1, identify those people and replace it with 4. Same way with 3. So this is how you can actually break your data down by multiple categories, and instead of having a mean of entire range using to fill up the missing values, this can be a better way of using missing value, filling up missing values by taking only the numbers around those data points, calculating their mean and filling it. Did that answer your question? Earlier you were asking on how do we do a 25 percentile and then take a mean of that. This is how
it is. This looks good. Yeah, thank you.
Bharat, I have a doubt.
Yeah.
You're filling the details of the age and you're categorizing with respect to the age. Then how you will fill the details of that age? What the method you told me is understood, but you're filling the missing details of the age itself, right?
Okay. Got it. Yeah. So perhaps when you classify it, the 25 percentile, 30th percentile, something, you would do it on some other category. I was just showing it as a toy example. So perhaps you can use it as a fair, perhaps. So people between certain fairs, if they are younger, because we saw it in the scatter plot, there was some relation between age and that. So you can use other categories to fill missing values of some
With the relationship between those two, we can do it. But as of now, when we are filling the age and we are categorizing the age,
This way you can't, because you don't know which percentile does this fit into.
Yes.
Yeah, but you can always bucket by something else. So let's say I want to, this missing value has to be filled. I can categorize all the, I can break this data set into females and males and take average of only females and use that to fill that. But the method remains same. You will create a bucket. That bucket would be based on the gender. And then within that bucket, you would do a mean. If you have gone through the Pandas notebook, which I have sent, there is much more elegant way than all this typing. This is called group by method. So this is Titanic. I want it to be grouped by gender. Group by gender. And I want an average of what? I want an average of age. One single line. Earlier, I had to write all of this, create a bucket, filter out that bucket, calculate the mean of that bucket, and then arrive at this number. Now, this is more elegant and more Python way of doing it, where you group things by whatever you want and calculate mean of whatever you want within this group. So this one line did everything that I was explaining. Now you can directly take these values. You can store this somewhere and use that to plug in the missing values by whatever filter you want. Okay. So this is why it becomes important for you to be very comfortable with Python, Pandas and NumPy. It would be almost exclusively used from next session onwards. So what I would suggest is, I know we have gone through a lot. Trust me, this would be your hardest week, in sense it would be most challenging in terms of amount that you would have to cover. But once you're past this stage, everything would become very, very simple and intuitive when it comes to actual machine learning. So go through at least these two, the week 3 and week 4 material. You can skip certain parts, like if you are stuck anywhere, you're not able to understand something, text me anytime you want, email me anytime you want, I'll straight away reply. But this essentially covers your NumPy, Pandas, and visualization library like Seaborn and Matplotlib. These, when you see introduction to Matplotlib, it would be the same type of Jupyter notebook. You can skip if something looks very difficult or you're not able to understand it, just skip it, because it's very intuitive. As and when we're using machine learning, we would continue using this, but NumPy and Pandas, you should be very clear and thorough with. I have given a link, Test Yourself on Understanding of Pandas. It's an excellent website which I found. Here, it gives you all of this, and it has certain tests at the end on, and it has some difficulty levels as well. So how to keep only two topmost frequent values and replace everything else. It will have a solution and it will have a question. So this is the question. This is the input. This is the desired output that it is expecting. Try to recreate it in your Jupyter notebook. If you can't, refer the solution. But if you can answer these 50 odd questions, then you're thorough with your Pandas. You need not learn anything more for machine learning. So go through this material, week 4 material, and then next week, again, I will have a rundown of one notebook covering all the basics of NumPy, Pandas, and visualization. Just like today we analyzed Titanic dataset, I will pick up another dataset. Perhaps I can download movie ratings from IMDb and analyze this with an objective next time. Today we just did exploratory work. We didn't have any objective. Next week we'll have some objective to it, like we have 2.1 million records in IMDb database. I want to know what is the average rating given by people who like horror movies and are beyond 50 years old. Okay. And without having to analyze all the 2.1 million rows, how to do that? I'll pick up one notebook with very specific aim, but that would be the last session covering NumPy, Pandas and Matplotlib and Seaborn. After that, we are going to start directly with machine learning, and I would not refer these back. So this week, please, I know it's a little rigorous material, but spend at least 1 hour every day going through these, and I don't see any reason why you won't be able to do that. But you should be clear on your understanding of NumPy, Pandas at the minimum. Seaborn, you get some bonus points as well. Okay. So next 10 minutes, if anyone has any question, I'm more than happy to answer. After this session also, if you have any questions, if you get stuck anywhere, please feel free to email me or drop me a note anytime. So Bharat, if there are any questions, I'll take them now.
Bharat, one question.
Sure.
Now you just, you know, we work on you working on Titanic data. If I want to correlate two different set of file, can I do it? Like I have file A and file B, and I just want to pick one of the column from file A and one of the column file B, which has the same kind of data.
Excellent. Is it possible? In week 4 material, I have attached a notebook, 1 million movie ratings. These ratings are actually connected from 3 different files. So if you see, one file is rating, one file is user information, one file is movie information. I've given a link on where you can find this data. So this is movie lens data. This actually was collected by a group called Group Lens. This is acquired by Steven Spielberg now. But this group tried to do machine learning, and based on this this thing, Steven Spielberg actually did quite a lot of analytics on what is the things that people like, and then he started making movies to that type. And it's quite interesting data set. So, but coming back to your point, it would cover 3 different data sets, and here you will exactly see the same thing that you're talking. How do we compare? So one of the data sets is about rating. The other one, it has just ID and timestamp and rating. The other one is about movie and movie ID. The third one is about users. How do we combine these and then do a correlation analysis and then do same type of graphing and all? So go through this, you will understand how to do it. It's very simple, actually.
Okay, we'll do that.
I have a question.
Sure.
I just wanted to know if you can come.
By the way, even before I answer your question, Swati, I wanted to tell everyone that Swati was kind enough to lease her private Zoom account to me so that we don't have multiple sessions, and it's because of her that we are able to have one seamless long session. Thank you so much, Swati.
Thank you, Swati.
You're welcome. Thank you for this session as well. I just wanted to know if we can use functions like correlation or covariance in this particular data set of Titanic. Like, for example, if there is a correlation between gender and survival rate, as you have discussed earlier.
Right. So it is as simple as typing Titanic.cor.
Okay.
I've just typed this, and what it has done is it has taken every possible numerical field and calculated correlation with every other field. So if I see, and you know, these are quite a lot of numbers, just as how we did with PD dot cross tab missing values, and we visualized it. So same way, let's draw a heat map on these numbers. Exactly the same. So this is the correlation values. This is called correlation metric. Correlation metric, I've put it as a heat map. Now the darker numbers mean lesser amount of correlation. The lighter colors mean more amount of correlation. So obviously diagonal elements are correlated itself. So passenger has one correlation with passenger ID. But if you see what is the lightest in this P class and identifier are highly correlated. These number of siblings so this makes sense. SIB was number of siblings and PR was number of parents. The parents and siblings traveling together. So these two are highly correlated, around 0.5 or something. So this is how you draw correlations and heat maps. Now, essence of machine learning, as like I would cover in next to next class, is being able to identify similarity between two different objects, and correlation matrix is central to this entire idea. I'll discuss more when I reach these algorithms, but some of the core algorithms used in machine learning is essentially based on ability to calculate correlation matrices and then calculate what does this 0.31 mean? Like, is it good? Is it bad? What does it mean in relation with something like 0.4? But to answer your question, this is how you draw correlations and visualize correlations as well.
Yeah, that's really nice. Thank you.
No problem.
Can you point us to the link where you said as day one you do this, day two you do this? I was going through your website and I could not get to that.
Right. So even before I just forgot to explain this. So this is the heat map I have put. This is a visual representation. These are numbers. If I want numbers also to be put here, there is some. So I just press Alt Tab. It gives me everything that I can do with this heat map function. I see something called anode. Now if I read what is anode about, anode, rectangular data set optional. If true, write the data values in each cell. That's what I wanted. So I'll type anode and it said if true, it gives me these numbers. You see these numbers coming here now. Okay, sorry to interrupt again. What was the question?
Yeah, I actually, maybe I'm negligent, but I could not find the place where you were telling us day one you do this, day two you do this to
come. Oh, okay. So you go to the website. In website, you click bootcamp. Okay. This is the material. Okay, so this is fifth week's material. Today's material, I would have expected you to cover these. I have not uploaded or I have not created a link for the next session, which would be on 12th. So 12th, I'll do it now. If you click that material, you will be able to see it. Otherwise, whenever you reach this page, you can actually click this bootcamp. You will have access to everything in future also. So let's say...
Yeah, I see this page. Yeah.
Okay, you see this page. Then week 5, 19th September, that is the next session. Not 19th September.
12th September.
12th. 12th. If you click 12th, you will have this. Day 1, day 2, day 3. You will have this movie data set as well.
But I don't see the 12th September anywhere.
Oh, are you going the same way? So like if you click, so we were here, in here. Okay. From bootcamp, I clicked on 5th September and I clicked this link. And then first thing I see is 12th September. You can't see that?
One second. I click on the 5th September material. Oh, okay. I see week 3, 5th September.
You don't see week 4?
Somehow I don't. Maybe I'm doing something wrong.
Yeah, we can see it. You need to click on ML Bootcamp on the top of the gun. You will find. Yeah.
Click here, ML Bootcamp, and then you will get a list like this. So what I do is I prepare 2 weeks ahead and keep posting these links only for the next session. But in case you are done with this session and you want to advance more, you can just click Bootcamp. It will have future session data as well. So you'll see week 4, week 5th data also. This is the book I'm going to refer. I have uploaded the book, the checklist, same way. So refer week 4 and you will have this entire thing. So this is what you would be doing this week.
Okay.
And next week, just one final rundown covering comprehensively NumPy, pandas, matplotlib, and then we begin our journey to proper machine learning. By this time, you would have learned everything you need to know about Python. All the jargon, everything that you need to know to start machine learning. We would start with simple linear regression after that. Okay. So this week, spend some time going through this. Yes, Vikas.
Yeah, sorry. Just one question. So is there, apart from Python, is there anything that we should have a knowledge on, say graphs or statistics or, as you said, you know, mean or certain mathematical or statistical terms, is there a reference for that? Or do you basically personally refer to certain sites or certain materials to get an idea of the fundamentals of statistics or graphs or anything else?
Yes, but the reason why I didn't put a separate session just on statistics is because of two things. One, maths and statistics is dry and boring as hell. Just studying statistics or just studying equations is always boring. At least I find it very boring. And So what I wanted to do was, while doing machine learning, I would explain what does an algorithm do line by line. So when I explain linear regression, I would explain all the underlying mathematics, all the underlying statistics with it. But if you see week 5, so I would have said, understand chapter 1 and try reading chapter 2 of the book which I have recommended, this. So that actually would have certain elements of this. Watch these videos. So I have clicked the link. So if you click this link, you would have this. So it would have linear regression part 1, linear regression part 2. And I have identified the videos which do not use too many equations and give you intuitive view to it. So these of all, like, I have learned it from multiple sources. And I was always confused on certain sources are bad, certain would be good. So over a period of time, what I find the best is what I've put here. So I'll, as and when whatever I think would be required for the next week, same way, I would keep adding it to the material. And all you need to understand is just if you follow this schedule, you should know everything that you are required to understand the topic.
Sure. Okay. Thanks, Bharat. One more question, Bharat. So this is basically from my workplace. So I had it is slightly digressing from our topic right now, but we have a downstream client which is trying to move to Python, and he's sourcing some data from us. And he was basically looking for our normal web service or MQ connection, but which would be, so we have a Java client, sample Java client already. So he wants something in, say, a sample Python client. So could you kind of direct me to certain references or materials that I should look for if I have to give him a sample Python code, which would basically take care of all the MQ connections and set up a data service or MQ service between
upstream and downstream? Yeah, so if you just type MQ service Python, using Python and WebSphere, like first 10 things, would exactly show you what you require. And there are quite a lot of clients already built, like RabbitMQ is quite prevalent. IBM MQ is a Python module in itself. It just takes 3 lines of code to exactly replicate what Java does in 300 lines of code. And all of this is available. Like, you just have to type MQ service in Python. I personally recreate these services using Django framework. But that's, again, it's quite intense and you'll have to learn it from scratch. But again, if you want to implement anything directly or give it a sample, you just type MQ services in Python and it will give you all the libraries in which it is possible. There are multiple libraries to do that.
Thanks, Bharat.
Sure. So in case no other questions, I would conclude this session. Please spend time going through the material which I've shared for week 4. Be comfortable with NumPy Pandas. Feel free to approach me anytime you want. Next week would be the last time I would be covering NumPy and Pandas. And after that, we start with our machine learning journey. Okay. So thanks for joining this session. Enjoy rest of your weekend. I'll see you next week again. Thank you.
Thank you, Bharat.
Thank you.
Thanks, Bharat. Thanks.
Thanks, Bharat.
Sure. Thanks.